Introduction. And well, before starting, I would really like to thank all the organizers for the effort they put to make this event well eventually work out. And well, despite the very unfortunate situation we are living in, so really thank you very much. As for today, I will try to introduce you to the method of multipliers that has originally arisen in a purely PDE framework, but that recently has been recognized as very useful also in spectral theory. And in particular, I will share with you a recent work in collaboration with Luca Fanelli and David Krejcirik, in which we developed the method of multipliers in order to detect sufficient and physically natural condition in order to guarantee the absence, the total absence of eigenvalues for diverse non-self-adjoint Hamiltonians, so like Schrödinger, Dirac, and Pauli operators. So, well, we will be mainly concerned, therefore, with this kind of Hamiltonian, that is a perturbed Hamiltonian. So we have that this is nothing but the sum in a form sense of two operators, the operator H naught, which is our reference operator, and V, which is our perturbation. And since we want to work in a non-self-adjoint framework, we will assume that V is possibly complex valued. And moreover, we will consider both the situation in which our configuration space is the whole Euclidean space RD. Also, I will show you how to refine the method in order to obtain meaningful result when we consider non-trivial subset of it. And we want to answer a very natural question in perturbation theory. That is the following. So let's suppose to have our reference operator H naught, let's suppose to know the spectrum of this operator. Well, the question is what one can say about the spectrum of the perturbed operator. And in particular, we are interested in considering what happens to the eigenvalue. So we will consider just the point spectrum of the operator. And basically, we will consider Hamiltonian. So our reference operator H0 will be an Hamiltonian for which we know that the point spectrum is empty. And what we will show using the method of multiplier is that this property remains stable also in the perturbed setting. Of course, this in general is not true, that is for whatever perturbation, this is not true. But what we could find with the method of multipliers is that this is possible if we consider two types of perturbation. So a first type of perturbation that I call good perturbation are perturbation which help the operator in keeping the property we are interested in stable. So if we want to, if we have as main goal the idea to prove absence of bound state, of course one can think that a good perturbation for this kind of problem is to assume to consider repulsive potential. And so if a good perturbation is a repulsive potential, well, then we are also able to consider a bad perturbation, so in this case, an attractive potential, but we need to control this bad behavior in a suitable way. So we need to assume some smallness of this perturbation compared to the reference operator H0. Well, so let's start step by step. So let's start considering as a starting point the Hamiltonian H0 to be the Laplace operator. So we consider the Schrödinger operator. And let's see how to apply the method in the self-adjoint situation first, just to see later on what are the main changes comparing the two different frameworks, so the self-adjoint and the non-self-adjoint situation. So and the idea of the method of multiplier is just to proceed by contradiction. So we want to disprove presence of eigenvalues. So we consider by contradiction that we do have a solution of the eigenvalue problem where the spectral parameter is denoted by lambda. And of course, since we are in the self-adjoint case, this is a real parameter. And then we proceed with the method. So this means just to consider the weak formulation of the problem, and we decide and we take a suitable test function. In this case, we consider the following skew-symmetric multiplier, so the commutator between the free Hamiltonian and x squared. And then we take the real part of the resulting identities. Well, one can immediately see that since the spectral parameter is real, well, the real part does not see the spectral parameter. So we have on the right-hand side the real part of this L2 inner product. And since we have a commutator between two symmetric operator, and therefore the commutator is a skew-symmetric operator, this L2 inner product is purely imaginary. And so when we apply the real part, the right-hand side disappear. And the important fact is that it's not just that disappear the right-hand side, but since we want to disprove total absence of eigenvalues, we want to have something which does not depend on the eigenvalue itself. So it is true that it disappears the right-hand side, but even more, it disappears the presence of the eigenvalue. And then we consider the left-hand side, just doing some trivial computation, one can see that the left-hand side is nothing but the L2 product of this double commutator between the full Hamiltonian and our multiplier. So in order to find condition to obtain a contradiction, we need to study the following double commutator. So we just do the computation, and it appears that the left-hand side, from the computation of the left-hand side, we obtain a term that is the L2 norm of the gradient of U that comes from the kinetic part of the equation, and then we obtain a term which depends on the perturbation, and in particular, it depends on the radial derivative of the perturbation. But let me stress that this term does not just only depend on the radial derivative of the potential, but it depends in a way that is the sign of the radial derivative of the potential, which gives the sign of the whole term. So in this sense, we are able to find, in this meaning, we are able to find repulsivity condition, so physically natural repulsivity condition, in order to get the absence of the eigenvalues. Because of course, if we assume that this term has a sign, and in particular, if we assume that the radial derivative is negative, then we obtain, with the price of having an inequality here, we obtain the following inequality, which immediately ensures that the only possibility for U is to be the trivial solution, and therefore the spectrum of the full Hamiltonian. The point spectral of the full Hamiltonian is the empty set, as it was in the self-adjoint case. Well, for those of you, if we have seen that the good assumption on the potential is to assume the negativity of the radial derivative of the potential, well, we have said that we also want to control a bad behavior of the potential, that in this case is represented by the positive part of the radial derivative. And if we assume that this positive part is controlled in this way, so in this sort of RD type subordination with respect to the Dirichlet form, well, we just use this information and the suitable smallness condition in order to get from this identity here also the absence of the eigenvalues, just using the smallness condition that we have supposed before. So, and now for those of you who are familiar with the Moore theory, well, you can say that you recognize somehow some ideas of the Moore theory, because the Moore theory starts with the very basic observation that if U is a solution of the eigenvalue problem of the self-adjoint Schrödinger operator, well, just using the symmetry of the Hamiltonian, one can observe that one has this equality here. So the L2 product of this commutator is equal to zero, where A denotes a whatever, well, so, well, up to now, A denotes a whatever operator which has a meaning somehow, is meaningful. But in the particular case, of the Schrödinger operator, one fix as A, the generator of the dilation, and one C, that one can also compute explicitly the commutator, which is nothing but the contribution of these two terms. Then one plug this information in the previous identity, and one observe immediately how to obtain a contradiction from that, and so how to obtain that we don't have actually an eigenfunction, just to assuming some sign condition on the potential. So, of course, if one assumes that this quantity is negative since the left-hand side is positive, well, we obtain a contradiction. And in this framework, I would like to cite some recent work by Avranska, Lukarska, Undermark, and Kovalczyk, in which they prove, using this method, the absence of positive eigenvalues for self-adjoint Schrödinger operator. But then, what are the similarities with our method? Well, if you remember, before I was saying that we wanted to study a double commutator between HV, so our Hamiltonian, and our multiplier. But then here we see in the more theory case that the only need is to study a commutator between HV and the operator A. But then one realizes that A and our test function are somehow related. So if one computes, this commutator here, one realizes that this is nothing but 4 times I the dilation operator. So this means that study the commutator between HV and A is the same as study the double commutator between HV and our multiplier. So, and moreover, of course, using our method, we obtain the same condition in order to guarantee emptiness of the point spectrum. Unfortunately, the Moore theory does not fit well with the non-self-adjoint framework. As you can see here, this was really important to have a symmetric operator. But on the other hand, the method of multiplier, as proved by Fanelli, Krajicik, and Vega in a work of the 2018, actually the method of multipliers does work also in this framework. So one can notice that in the case of the non-self-adjoint Schrödinger operator, well, the spectrum, of course, is no more necessarily real. And then now let's see how to apply the method, and let's see how, well, using the same approach as before, let's see what are the main changes. So first of all, just to emphasize that we have a no more necessary real spectrum, we consider the spectral parameter, and I explicitly write the real part and the imaginary part of the parameter. Then the idea is to use the same approach as before. So we multiply in L2 sense by the skew symmetric multiplier, and then we take the real parts. So now the difference compared to the previous case is that the right-hand side does not disappear anymore, because we need to take into account that we have this non-necessarily trivial imaginary part of the spectral parameter. And moreover, the problem with this term is that not only depends on the eigenvalue itself, but it does not have a sign. So this means that we realize, or rather they realize, that one identity is not enough to get the absence of the eigenvalue. But then one can remediate and see what one could do with this term here. And then there is just a very basic observation that says, okay, let's suppose to have two real numbers, so A and B, that are, for instance, positive real number. Of course, minus 2AB is a negative number. Okay, how do we get some positivity to that? So we usually want to assume some positivity in order to get our contradiction. So how do we get positivity from that? Well, we just add something else, so A square and B square, and from that we obtain a positive quantity. So we understand that in order to get some useful identity, we need just to add to this identity here some other identities obtained multiplied by the asymmetric multiplier, so by a function phi u, and then take the real parts and the imaginary parts. And then making a good algebra that I won't show you here, and with suitable choices of the function phi, we obtain the following identity here. where the bad term that was in the left hand side, in the right hand side here, it appears now here. And then it seems that we are not getting any better, actually, but somehow we needed to use some ideas that date back to the 60s and the 70s, in which Eidus and Ikeben, in order to study some limiting absorption principle for the electromagnetic Helmholtz equation, they needed to prove some uniform resultant estimate. And in order to obtain this uniformity, they needed to introduce the following relative function to the function u itself, which is denoted by u minus, and which is nothing but that u multiplied by a phase factor, which depends on the real and imaginary part of the game values. And then what is important for us is that if one computes the square of the absolute value of the gradient of u minus, this is is nothing but the sum of these three terms. And why this is important? This is important because if one look at our identity again, one realizes that the first row is nothing but the L2 norm now of the gradient of u minus. And then the tricky part that did not have a sign before, now using this new function u minus is nothing but that the weighted L2 norm of the gradient of u minus, where it appears the dependence upon the given value, but this dependence now is positive. So we can get rid of this term just with the price of obtaining here an inequality. And then there are terms which depends on the potential that, of course, we need to see how to deal with. But this we have more or less already done before. So just using some other integration by part, we obtain that we want to understand how to get some useful inequality from the term involving the potential. And then what we realize is that, again, this term depends on the radial derivative of the potential in a way that is the sign of the radial derivative, which gives the sign to the term. So we understand that we need to assume some repulsivity condition, or better, we need to assume that the attractive part of the potential is small enough. And then we have a term which depends on the imaginary part of V. And in this situation, we have the only choice to assume smallness of the imaginary part. And then just using some Cauchy's various inequality from this identity here, we obtain an inequality like this one. And then if these small constants are small enough indeed, then also in these situations and also in the non-self-adjoint situation, one gets absence of total absence of eigenvalues. So now, so far, well, even if I didn't mention strongly enough, we were working on the whole Euclidean space RD. But actually, in collaboration with David Krejcirik, we also obtained some meaningful result if we restrict to non-trivial domains, so non-trivial subset of RD. And in particular, I want to show a recent work in which we consider as a starting point the L space domain. So the game value problem in this situation has this form. So we have that here we have the game value equation for the Laplacian, and then we have some boundary condition, some Roban boundary condition in which it appears the dependence upon the perturbation that now, well, is this function alpha that played the role of the function B in the previous case. So somehow you can think to this problem as if we are considering the free Schrödinger operator, which is perturbed by a potential which is supported on the boundary. So somehow the problem is self-adjoint or not depending on the boundary condition. And then just doing the same as before, we obtain the analogous identities to the whole Euclidean space case. So one can see that as soon as we are considering the interior of the domain, well, we obtain exactly also with the introduction of the function u minus, also in this situation, we obtain exactly the same terms as before. But then if one looks at the part in the potential, well, also the form of this term is more or less similar to the previous one, but now the integrals are over the boundary, not anymore on the whole domain. And this, of course, creates some problem because we cannot just assume, so we want to get from this term some small term which depends, which depends on the L2 norm of the gradient of U on the whole domain. But here we are supported on the boundary. So we realize that we cannot get that right away as before, but the remedy is somehow related to some trace arguments, say. And indeed, what we know is that so we get rid of the first term just using some repulsivity, and then we understand, so we want to obtain from this term here a contribution of an L2 norm of the gradient 1/2, so just 1/2 derivative on, so because we know through the trace theorem that we can control 1/2 derivative on the boundary with a full derivative on the full domain. So from this term, we want to get somehow the L2 norm of the gradient 1/2. And to do that, we need to somehow fractionally integrate by part and using the Kato-Pons inequality to do that. And as soon as we do this fractional integration by part and we assume some smallness condition, so we assume some smallness on the potential itself, well, again, from this term, we obtain the contribution that we want. And then, as I was already anticipating, we just use the trace argument, which says that we can control the H1/2 norm of U minus on the boundary with the full gradient, the full L2 norm of the gradient in the whole domain. And therefore, if the smallness is the smallness constant is sufficiently small, indeed, also in this domain case, we can obtain absence of eigenvalues. Well, just to to conclude, say, this method has been recognized as very robust, and indeed it can be generalized to treat also other models. So again, Fanelli, Krejcirik, and Vega consider apply the model also to disprove presence of eigenvalues in the electromagnetic framework. So considering now the electromagnetic Schrödinger operator, in which instead of the normal Laplacian here, we have the magnetic Laplacian. So A is the magnetic vector potential, which is related to the magnetic field B. And of course, reproducing the same algebra, one obtained that in the identity that they got, it appears a new term which depends on the vector field, on the magnetic field itself, and is a term of this form here. And then we realized that in order to control this term, one also assumes some smallness condition on the magnetic field B of this type. And if the smallness is strong enough, say, also in this situation, they could get absence of point spectrum. What is important is that this condition does not, the condition to ensure absence of eigenvalues does not depend on the vector field A, but it depends on the magnetic field. That is the only physical relevant, say, field. And this makes a difference with other work in the subject. For instance, Koch and Tataru, they proved some absence of point spectrum using as conditions some condition which depends on the gauge. So somehow not really physical conditions. Then Also, this method can be applied to the Lamé operator, as I showed in my PhD thesis. And also recently, we applied the method to consider matrix-valued electromagnetic Schrödinger operators. And what's the reason why we wanted to apply the method to consider, say, systems, so matrix-valued operators? And the reason why is that we wanted to go beyond this spinless case and to consider also some models which take into account the interaction of the magnetic field with the spin. So it's not surprising that the method worked for the Pauli operator, which is an operator of this form in which you have the dependence. So the interaction with the spin is taken into account in this term here, that as soon as it is treated as at the same level of the perturbation B, well, of course, one can think that it's reasonable to obtain absence of eigenvalues also for this model. And then we applied the same result for the Dirac operator that was a little bit more surprising because it's a first order operator, whereas the other method were all of them second order operator. But then in order to treat this model, we use the supersymmetry structure of the Dirac operator. That means that squaring out the operator, it gives a contribution that is nothing but the Pauli operator on a shifted Pauli operator on the diagonal line, and also using the result for the Pauli operator, we could get absence of the eigenvalues also for the magnetic Dirac operator. And this is how we applied the method of multiplier, and basically is everything I wanted to say. So thank you very much for the attention, and sorry for the 1 minute late.
Okay, thank you. Questions? Comments? So anybody can ask?
What is the condition in practice on the magnetic field? I mean, the magnetic field should be small to get...
Let's consider the electromagnetic Schrödinger. So we assume this smallness condition. So it's a sort of RD type smallness condition. So where we have where the smallness is encoded in the constant here that is denoted by B squared.
It's hard to show it for any function just because the standard is just curl A give you the integral of this magnetic gradient square gives you the integral of curl A of B U square. You're asking for X square B square.
So yeah. So
it just looks like maybe when it's very small, I don't know how to show it for a particular operator.
So, for instance, one can prove it in the case of Aronov bomb potential. So somehow, for the Aronov bomb potential, the
method works. For the case, yes, I see. Okay.
And somehow, in order also to
find the fixation on different magnetic fields. Yes.
Okay.
Any other question? Okay.
Maybe I missed some point. As far as I remember, you write the eigenvalue in the form lambda plus I epsilon, and then you showed that if epsilon is small, you have a contradiction. No?
Not really. No. We don't assume anything to anything for the spectral parameter. So here, probably I didn't say so,
it's independent of epsilon.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, so it is independent. So in this case, so I can understand that, for instance, in the here in the identity that I obtain. So for instance, there is a lambda here that is in the denominator. So somehow it's weird that it works out for every spectral parameter. But in this case, I was just focusing on the case in which lambda is greater or equal than the imaginary part, and then in the case of this being strictly greater than zero, that is just the most difficult part, because we are, so this means that we are considering the sector which includes the essential spectrum, so which includes the positive real line. So is somehow reasonable to think that is the most difficult part. The other case, so when we are outside of this sector, well, basically the technique works as in the self-adjoint case. So, well, that's true that I didn't emphasize that, but in this works in this under this condition, and the other case is much simpler. So,
now
we don't assume anything about.
Because I thought you get only that there are no point spectrum in some sector, but okay.
No, that's true. I mean, I didn't say so, but this works just in this sector, but the complementary case is much simpler, and it can be dealt as in the self-adjoint case, but we obtain total absence of eigenvalues, so in the whole complex plane.
Okay, thank you.